dedicate this song to recession, depression, and unemployment. This song is for you.
Today's a new day.
I'll be honest with you.
I almost gave up, but a power that I can't explain fell from heaven like a shower now.
When I think of how much better I'm gonna be when this is over, I
smile,
smile.
Even though I hate, see, I smile,
smile.
I know God is working, so I smile,
smile.
Even though I'm in it for a while,
what's it gonna
smile,
do? Now every day is not gonna be perfect, but it still doesn't mean it doesn't have purpose. Where's the love, y'all?
Where is the love and the joy that you promised and tell me it's alright?
The truth is,
I almost gave up a power that I can't explain.
That Holy Ghost power, y'all.
Fell from heaven like a shower now.
Yeah, I know we've been hurt, but still, I
smile,
smile.
Even though I hurt, see, I smile,
smile.
I know God is working, so I smile.
Yeah, that feels
even
good.
Even though I'm in it for a while, I
still
smile,
smile.
So I do look up when you've been down.
Smile.
Show the case to see you give a now.
God's people.
So much better when you smile.
Let's go. Whatever you're going through right now.
Smile.
And my people say,
oh, oh, oh.
While you're waiting,
so much better when you're oh, oh, oh.
And while you're praying,
so much better when you're oh, oh, oh.
Look in the mirror,
so much better when you're oh, oh, oh.
Always remember,
so much better when you're
to smile.
I almost gave up, but a power that I can't explain.
That Holy Ghost power, y'all,
fell from heaven like a shower.
And I hope you, through heartaches, difficulties,
right now,
tears, storms, all things are working.
Because
you're a winner. Look in the mirror. Let's go.
You look so
homestead. Miami. Flint, Michigan. Chicago, Illinois. LA. Jersey. LA. Always remember, smile.
Because
we just don't want you to be happy. We want you to have something that's happening. We want you to have that joy. Can take it from you.
Hey, good morning, Refuge. Let's begin this time of worship by asking God's presence to be on us and with us as we enter into this time of worship. I don't know what your week was like. I don't know what you went through, but all I know is that prayer changes things, and even when it doesn't change things, it changes us. So let's enter into this time of worship asking God's presence to be with us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We glorify you. We magnify your great name. There is none like you in all of the earth. How great you have been. You have kept us. You have protected us. You have preserved our lives. And now, God, we are at this point standing in need of another little moment with you. So, Lord, I pray, whether we're on our jobs, whether we're in our homes, whether we're gathered with family, whether we're scattered away from our loved ones, whether we're all by ourselves, I ask that the presence of the Holy Spirit would rest in this worship experience. Even though it is virtual, let us feel you and feel the connection to one another through you. Lord, have your way. Glorify yourself. Meet somebody's needs. Speak to our hearts. Let signs, wonders, and miracles follow your preached word. And we pray that by the time we get done with what we have to do and what we are saying, let you be glorified. Let Jesus be lifted up and let your people be blessed. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, Refuge family, it's time for our faith declarations. We've been saying this every Sunday because sometimes you got to rehearse and rehash what it is you believe. So it's right here on your screen. Let's go ahead and say this together. For all I've been through, and with all my Savior has done, I declare he's bringing it all together for me in 2021. Oh, bless God. It's time to pass the peace right now. That newness, that wholeness that you feel having rehearsed and rehashed what you believe, it's time to share that with somebody. You can drop an encouraging comment, a welcoming message to somebody in the comment section of whatever platform you're watching. You can shoot a text message to somebody anywhere in the world and invite them to come and worship right here with us in this space. It's time to pass the peace.
You. purpose. It reaches to me.
Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this time, this opportunity that we have today to spend time in your word. I pray, Lord God, that as we talk, as we read your word, as we spend this time in hearing conversation with you, that you would allow us to hear your heart for your church in these days and in these times, that we wouldn't be so caught up in the apathy and in the panic that seems to be setting in a lot of cases in our society. But that, Lord, we would have our hope and our trust put in you, in what you have built in calling us to be the church. So, Lord, for these next few moments, stand in my body, think with my mind, speak with my tongue. Cause us to hear truth that will transform us and put our hope back in you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Well, listen, I'm still dealing with this idea of the church gathered, the church scattered, the idea of being committed and connected. I'm dealing with, where do we go as the church, especially the church in the United States, in these days and in these times, and as we move into the next wave of whatever's happening in a global pandemic, and the church is still seeming to be divided between who's going to church and who's not going to church. And with all of that, I've been trying to help us see that worrying about who is and who ain't is actually the wrong fight to be in. And so I want you to join me back in Acts chapter 8. I'm going to pick up in verse 4 and verse 5, but I want to read a little bit more dealing with one of the first deacons, this guy named Philip. And I want us to see, and I want us to focus on some things as it relates to what it means to be the church in this day and in this time. Acts chapter 8, verses 4 and 5, starting there, reading from the New Living Translation, the Bible says, "But the believers who were scattered preached the good news about Jesus wherever they went. Philip, for example, went to the city of Samaria and told the people there about the Messiah." Jump down to verse 26. "As for Philip, an angel of the Lord said to him, 'Go south down the desert road that runs from Jerusalem to Gaza.' So he started out and he met the treasurer of Ethiopia, an official of great authority under Candace, the queen of Ethiopia. The official had gone to Jerusalem to worship, and he was now returning. Seated in his carriage, he was reading aloud from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Then the Holy Spirit said to Philip, 'Go over and walk along beside the carriage.' Philip ran over and heard the man reading from the prophet Isaiah. Philip asked, 'Do you understand what you're reading?' The man replied, 'How can I unless someone instructs me?' And he urged Philip to come up into the carriage and sit with him." Verse 35. "So beginning with the same scripture from Isaiah, Philip told the official the good news about Jesus. As they rode along, they came to some water, and the official said, 'Look, there's some water. Why can't I be baptized?' He ordered the carriage to stop, and they went down into the water, and Philip baptized him." I want to talk about, just for a few moments, I want to talk about power and purpose in the pew. Power and purpose in the pew. Now remember, as the writer of Acts is beginning to tell the story of the Spirit's development of the church as she seeks to fulfill the great commission that Jesus gave her in Acts chapter 1 verse 8, we see the church now facing this time of persecution, this time of upheaval, where some have chosen to gather, some have chosen to scatter. Remember that persecution caused the church to really kind of wrestle with and theologically deal with, what does it mean to be the church? How do we do church? How is church supposed to look? What is the right way to do church? What is the wrong way to do church? And they had to discover, as we are having to rediscover, that the church is not about a building or a location, but it's an identity. It's who we are as those saved by the saving work of Jesus Christ and empowered by the Spirit, connected by the Spirit to the Father and to each other. This time of persecution caused some tough decisions. We already talked about how some made some decisions to continue to gather in public worship despite the risk of being imprisoned or even put in jail. Others, however, made decisions to stay away from the public worship over the issue of safety. But again, in Scripture, the ones who chose safety over gathering were not accused of, they were not treated like they were something was wrong with them, that they were too woke to be God's believers. None of that was ever seen in Scripture. Because those who gathered, they chose to be a visible expression of the church. But those who scattered had faithfully committed themselves to be a virtual extension of the church. So there is the visible expression and there is the virtual extension of the church. Both of them, however, as we have talked about, had the same vision, had the same vibe, and had the same vocation of making disciples. And as the writer of Acts, as Luke continues to identify these groups and how the Spirit used them to develop the church, whether they were virtually an extension or whether they were a visible expression, he talks about it as being a unified operation and growth of the church. So now check this out. The visible expression, the people who continued to gather, they had to choose to commit to a ministry of purposeful reconciliation. 2 Corinthians 5:18, we have been called, we've been given the ministry of reconciliation. They had to make some decisions to be committed to in their gathering and what they did and how they did it to purposefully be about and incorporate in their relationships reconciliation. Now, I'm going to deal with them on next week. I want to focus on the virtual extension folk, the scattered folk, because the virtual extension people had to commit to the ministry, listen, not of purposeful reconciliation, but of personal responsibility. They had to choose to be personally responsible for the vision and the vibe and the vocation of the church and not depend on somebody else who was gathering to do church and church activities in the calling of what it meant to be the church. Stick with me because I'm going somewhere on this one. Watch this. You have the visible expression, you have the virtual extension of the church, yet they are one church. But it still begs the question of why? Why would God allow this time of persecution, this time of upheaval that seemed to be causing division in the body of Christ? Now, go back and recognize what God was up to, because we'll discover as we read through what's happening, especially in Acts chapter 8, we'll discover that what God was up to then is the same thing God is up to now. Because remember, back in verse 1 of verse 8, it says that this persecution broke out and they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria. Because they had focused just on Jerusalem, they were failing to fulfill the directive of Acts 1:8 to take the gospel from Jerusalem to Judea and Samaria and then ultimately to the uttermost parts of the earth. Because they were stuck on where the location was, he used the persecution, he used the upheaval to scatter them to where he wanted them to go. But the verse also says, notice this, that they were all scattered except the apostles. Notice this, the people who Jesus had given the directive to ensure that this thing called the church would take off and become what it was supposed to be, they were the ones who were still committed in that part of that group in terms of being committed to the visible expression. The apostles stayed put. Because listen, even though this persecution came about and caused some people to scatter and some people to be gathered, the apostles, the church leadership, was still there in the visible expression while making sure that what was happening in the virtual extension was still all a part of the same thing. See, ours is not a theology like Catholicism. We don't wait on a pastor or a priest or a professional clergy to be around, to experience, and to be a part of the miraculous work of ministry that our God has called us to. See, part of what has happened, especially in the American church, we got so comfortable letting folks on stage do ministry that we forgot that all of us have been called to ministry. Because in verse 4, the Bible says that when this persecution broke out, people were scattered, the apostles stayed put. But then verse 4 says, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the good news. They took the ministry of the preaching of Jesus and they took it to the streets. See, watch this. God desires to accomplish reaching the world for Jesus Christ, the message of the good news, and making them into disciples. He desires to accomplish this not through apostles or pastors, but in parishioners. That's why in Ephesians 5, 11 through 16, when it names off the, some say fivefold, but it's really the fourfold ministry of those who've been called to church leadership, it says now God has put them in place so that those individuals would equip the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. The building up of the body of Christ is not the job of the pastor or the leader. It's the job of all of us. Because I have noticed, my spiritual father used to say this all the time, that it's not shepherds who birth lambs. It's sheep who are supposed to birth lambs. See, God wants to put the power back in the pew. The Lord wants the same spirit, the same anointing that we love about our visible expression. He wants it in the streets through us. So listen, I'm running out of time. I got to hurry up and get to it, because listen, those who were a part of that virtual extension of the church, those who were scattered, those who made decisions to stay away for safety's sake, they had to commit to the ministry of personal responsibility. They had to be personally responsible for the call to make disciples in the then known world and bring people, men and women, boys and girls, into a saving relationship with Jesus Christ. They had to take that as their personal responsibility and not leave it up to the folks in Jerusalem to do or for the apostles to do, but for them to do it. So they went everywhere, the Bible says, preaching the word. See, Paul says it like this in 1 Corinthians 9 and 22. He says, I have become all things to all men that I might win some, that I try to find common ground with all kinds of people so that I can bring some folks into the saving relationship with Jesus Christ. That means, first of all, if I'm going to take this personal responsibility on as a virtual expression of the Church of Jesus Christ, that means I have to, first of all, interact creatively with people. I have to find new avenues to connect people, not necessarily to the church where I go, but to the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Notice this in verse 4, the Bible says that the believers who were scattered, they preached the good news about Jesus wherever they went, whether it was in the marketplace, whether it was in the political realm, wherever they went, they found a way to take the gospel with them and to make the gospel fit that particular situation and circumstance. Well, how did they do that? Look back at verse 26 of chapter 8. The Bible says that the Lord spoke to Philip, that there was an unctioning that was put in Philip to go down to the south by the desert road. Hang out here. This is the spot I want you to be in, and this is where I'm going to connect you with some people. Also in verse 29, now he gets spiritual instructions from the Holy Spirit to go and walk beside the carriage. See, God wants to inspire us with ideas of what to do in a virtual space, what to do online, what to do in certain chat groups, what to do in certain places, where to go, what social media platforms to be on, whatever the virtual expression is, the virtual extension is of us, of the church, we have to be it, and he will inspire us creatively on where to go and who to do, what to do and who to talk to. Because secondly, it's not just the being having that creativity, but we also have to be committed to intentional conversations. Notice that Philip takes it personally to be involved in person-to-person evangelism, person-to-person pre-evangelism, and person-to-person discipleship. Discipleship was never meant to be a program of the church. It was supposed to be the lifestyle of those who are the church. So you'll notice that that Philip connects with this guy named Simon in Acts chapter 8, verses 9 through 23. And it isn't necessarily a positive end to the story, but yet he takes the responsibility to connect person to person. He does it again with the Ethiopian official in verses 26 through 39. A disciple named Ananias takes that personal responsibility to intentionally conversate with Saul in Acts chapter 9, verses 10 through 19. And then Barnabas does the same thing with that same Saul in Acts chapter 9, verse 27. We have to take the responsibility in the platforms, in the avenues that God gives us as virtual extensions of the church, to be intentional that our conversations are pointing people back to Jesus and to discipleship. but that also means an intentional connectivity, that the people who were the virtual extension had to ensure that they were intentionally connected to the visible expression, even though they were the virtual extension. Because you'll notice, especially when you get to Acts chapter 9, verses 25 through 26, that the people that were reaching people for Jesus and bringing them into discipleship virtually were connecting them to the home base. In Acts chapter 9, verses 25 through 26, the believers in Damascus sent Saul back to the visible expression in Jerusalem to ensure that he was connecting with something that was larger than himself. But then you also notice, if you keep on reading, by the time you get to Acts chapter 11, verses 29 through 30, the people who were virtually extensions of the church, they maintained a financial as well as a spiritual connection and commitment to the home base, to the visible expression. Listen, God wants to put the power in the pew because he wants to use people like me and you in somebody else's life to intentionally bring up the conversations, to be creative about how to interact with people and how to connect them to the gospel, and then connecting them to what it means to be a part of even the visible expressions of what worship is. See, God is tired of bringing folks to a building. It's time for the church to be us wherever we are, that wherever we go, we would preach the gospel and let the power of God through us connect with people that would lead them into a saving relationship with Jesus Christ, and then connect them to this identity of what it means to be the church. So listen, even if you're one that you've made decisions based upon safety, it doesn't mean that you and I do not have to take personal responsibility as virtual extensions of the church to still be about the business of preaching the gospel and discipling people who come to know Jesus Christ personally. We still have a job to do because the power and the purpose God wants to put back in the pew. Can I pray for us? Father, we thank you that even though you know what you know about us, you want to co-labor with us. You want to use us. You want us to be about a purpose. So Father, whether that's in a hospital, whether that's on a job, whether that's as a retiree, whether that's on a social media platform, give us the power, give us the boldness, give us the courage to talk about our faith, to talk about our Jesus, and then invite people into one-on-one personal relationships that helps them come to know the real relationship through Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray that whether we are committed to being a part of the visible expression, or even if we have to be a part of the virtual extension, I pray that we would be one body in Christ, operating in the purpose and the power that you've called each of us to. In Jesus' name, amen. He wants to put the power, not in the pulpit, but back in the pew. Listen, it's offering time. It's time to bless God with our gifts of tithe, offering, or love offering. Whatever way that we give, remember, we always pause to make sure that we give as unto the Lord. And as you can see, there's four different ways that you can give. We want to make it easy for all of us to be obedient to the commands of Scripture. If you're saved, if you're a partner of this fellowship and you've made Jesus your Lord, then you know as a disciple that it's required of us to tithe, to take that percentage off the top and make sure that God's kingdom is blessed and that God's kingdom is enhanced for the ministry and for the work of ministry to go forth. Maybe you're ready to give an offering. Maybe God has just been so good. His grace has been so sufficient in your life and you just want to say thank you. You want to show your appreciation to him for all that he has been. Then it is certainly in order and in line to give an offering. Maybe you want to be a blessing to the preacher. You want to bless the man of God because something God has used me to say or do. You can do that through that what we call it as a love offering. All I know is that God says that he takes the blessing that would belong to the prophet and he lets it rest on you and on your life. So whatever way that you give, let's make sure that we give God our best. Let's continue to be a blessing to God because we are blessed to be a blessing. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you. We glorify you now for this opportunity that we have to worship you in giving. God, I pray that as we pour out our hearts, as we exhibit our love, our appreciation, our commitment to you, I pray that you would deepen our faith. I pray that you would deepen our resolve. I pray, Lord God, that you would respond as we have given unto you. Do what you said you would do in your word and open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings we wouldn't even have room enough to receive. Do it so that you and you alone will be the only one who gets all the credit for all that you're going to do in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's give as unto the Lord. Well, listen, as we wrap up today, I want to personally thank all of those for your expressions of love, kindness, whatever it may have been during this time of the loss of my grandmother. We actually didn't lose her. We know exactly where she is because she was a godly grandmother. I'm kind of like Timothy in 2 Timothy, where Paul says, you learn the scriptures from your grandmother Lois. I learned godliness from my grandmother Lois. And so it was actually a worship celebration of what God had done in saving her and then her passing that legacy on. And so the tears that were shed were mixed with laughter and praise. And so we're okay. We're doing okay. My mom's doing good. My aunts and my uncle are doing good. But I thank you for your prayers. Listen, I pray that whatever is about to jump off in your life this week, that you don't look at it with trepidation, that you're not anxious about it, because our God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we could even ask or think, because he's already put himself, the power in us that'll get us through it. Can I pray? Father, we love you. We bless you. We magnify you. You are amazing and you are worthy to be praised. Now, God, I pray that you would allow the grace, the power, the peace, and the love of God to rest on each of us, that it would abide in our lives so that we can dispense it to others who ask for this hope that we have. We thank you, Lord God, for how you're going to watch over us and keep us and lead us in a plain path for your name's sake this week. Do it, God, and we'll make sure you get all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, I love you. There's nothing that you can do about it. Can't wait to see you this next week.